Welcome to Sunday morning worship at Our Savior's Lutheran Church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Our Savior's is a congregation of people forgiven in Christ, whose mission is to proclaim the good news and connect faith to everyday life. We are glad you have chosen to worship with us. Our contemporary worship will begin in a few moments.
It sure is good to see you. I'm Pastor Justin. I'm here with Pastor Tim and this amazing Celebrate band. Let's say hello and thank you to them for this morning. Wow. They're going to be on fire today, and I think you will be too. I'm glad to see none of you physically on fire this morning. I hope that your soul feels on fire while you're here this morning with us. And this is another week in our Making the Grade worship series where we explore Jesus the teacher. And I want you to think about Jesus as a teacher and ready yourselves to learn something in this place today. Our gathering litany points to this fact. To Jesus, the great teacher, every human mystery was clear. And Jesus knew the mind of God better than we know our own. God, our faith seeks understanding. We want insight into this world and deeper knowledge of you. Holy Spirit, give us an inquisitive mind today. Give us flexible hearts. When we feel challenged by what we hear, quiet our spirits and settle our mouths so we might listen and understand. Friends, old wisdom, fresh ideas, friendly debate, renewed wonder, these are God's gifts for the curious heart. Jesus, we are here now, and we are ready to learn.
We encounter the presence of God in the words of Scripture. When we hear these words, we sit together at God's feet, and we encounter Jesus teaching and living in our midst. Please pray with me now, not just that God would speak to us in this moment, but also that we might listen and learn. We pray. God, when we learn from you, listening is never enough. One day you will call us to speak, to use our voice, to share the truth in love, to defend your people. Use the examples of Scripture to train us so that we might recognize the moment you call us beyond silence. Teach us, Jesus. Amen. A reading from James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it would not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Please rise for the gospel. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink, because you bear the name of Christ, will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter the life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eyes cause you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God.
Thank you, Mary. Well, dear friends in Christ, grace you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in prayer. God of mercy and grace, you teach us what it means to be your servant, but do we always listen or understand? Sometimes our own good intentions become stumbling blocks to others who seek to follow you. Help us to learn from your word today what it means to be your humble servant. Amen. Well, my friends, here we are in week 4 of, as Pastor Justin reminded us just a few moments ago, our sermon series, Making the Grade. And it has been an interesting journey so far, to say the least, as we've dealt with some, well, rather interesting Bible texts, like this one this morning, these past few weeks together. These texts that oftentimes leave us walking out of the worship service maybe with more questions than answers to what it is that we have just heard. In fact, last week we started to collect those questions of yours in the worship service, and we really enjoyed reading those. We gave out cards, and we invited you to write down your questions and reflections that you heard from the sermon, and we're going to do that again this week as well. Just a reminder, if you didn't get a card from one of the ushers this morning when you came in, you can get those still. You can raise your hand anytime during the service, I think. And anyway, write down your questions and reflections, and when you come up for communion, you can place them in the baskets that have been set up here on your way back to your seat, because we collect those cards, and we use them in our Sunday morning conversations that we're doing these weeks between worship services on Sunday morning in the Friendship Room. We invite you to join us there for a further discussion of these texts each week. We appreciate the way you've been participating in the sermons through these questions indeed. I loved to read those cards. I did it this week, and it was really interesting to hear some of the things that you asked, some of the things you thought about from last week's sermon, maybe in a whole new way. In fact, some of your questions from last week are a part of this message here this morning again as well. Some of the things that you wrote about on those cards kept coming to my mind as I was working on this message. And there was two things in particular that seemed to be a reoccurring theme on these cards as I read them. Number one was, how does God help us stay the course in our walk of faith? And number two was, how does God teach us to be humble servants? Now, let me just tell you right off the bat, when I read those cards, I got to the end of the stack and I said to myself, everybody gets an A+ from last week, because those are exactly the questions that we were dealing with. Those are exactly the things that Jesus was teaching about, his two main lesson points to his disciples within this section of reading from Mark's Gospel. Let me take a quick glimpse back to last week's message, and you'll see just what it is I'm talking about. Do you remember what the disciples were talking about as they walked that road to Capernaum last week? What it was they were discussing amongst themselves? Do you remember? Let me share just a couple of verses as a reminder. And as they came to Capernaum, when Jesus was in the house, he asked them, "What were you discussing on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had been discussing with one another who was the greatest. You remember? Jesus' lesson last week was a reading that reflected on humility. Jesus said, if anyone would want to be first, they must be servant of all and last of all. It was a lesson the disciples needed to learn as they walked this road of life and ministry with Jesus. A lesson on humility. Well, now this week, here we go again. John says to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." I don't know if you think so, but it appears to me that the disciples are still having a little bit of a problem when it comes to this lesson on humility today. I mean, just think of this for a moment, what he said to Jesus. Basically, he said to Jesus, this person is not a follower of, it was not one of us, Jesus, so we told him to stop acting like it. He's not one of us. John seemed proud to tell Jesus about his reprimand of this outsiders. And why do you suppose that was today? Now, before we judge John too harshly, let's just think about it for a moment. Perhaps what John was saying was well-intended. Did you ever consider that? Maybe John and the disciples were just trying to correctly stay the course in their ministry together. I mean, it wasn't an easy thing to follow Jesus, to say the least. They had learned so much from him. about what being a disciple and a servant was all about. In fact, they were called by him to be part of his special group. They were given a great responsibility to serve Jesus. And do you think they took this seriously? I do. I think they took it very seriously. And our question, our first one this morning, is this: do we? In the verses that follow, Jesus goes on to teach just how serious it is to be a follower of his. If you are a stumbling block to one of these little ones, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. Sounds serious. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better to be maimed than to go to hell. Again, serious. If your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better to be lame than be thrown into hell. If your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. Better to have one than have two eyes and be thrown into hell. Serious indeed. We had better know what it is we are doing if we are going to be a follower of Jesus. We'd better get it right. Not just anybody could do the work that we have been called to do. Do you suppose today the disciples were worried that the person casting out those demons in Jesus' name might be just getting themselves into trouble? So much so that they told this person to knock it off for their own good. Could it be? Did they care enough to keep the responsibilities of ministry out of the hands of the infants? Or did they become a stumbling block to the work of the Holy Spirit in all of us? Maybe Jesus' response to them gives us a clue. Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterwards to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose their reward." Do not stop him. Perhaps it was a lesson on humility once again today. It certainly sounds that way to me. But what if this time there was something a bit more for the disciples and for us to learn in Jesus' words? Jesus seems to welcome the work of this unknown person who was healing in his name. We don't know who the person was. We don't even know their name. This person was not part of the 12 recorded in Scripture who were part of Jesus' inner circle. Yet today we get a glimpse of who this person is within this story, within this invitation that Jesus gives to them. Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will soon afterwards be able to speak evil of me. Do not stop him. Do not become a stumbling block to the work of the Holy Spirit within another. Within another. Question number two: just who is this other in today's gospel story? Oh, we think we know. The others are those who don't understand their faith as well as we do our own. The others are those who don't have any answers to their questions about God or who Jesus is or what their faith is all about. And it's not that we have anything against them. It's just that they don't know what we know. They're like little ones. So we'd better not trust them with the responsibilities of ministry that are ours. It's best that they know their place like we know ours. Jesus said, If any of you puts a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for them if a great millstone were hung around their neck and they were thrown into the sea. The little ones that Jesus speaks of today are those who are infants in the faith. The little ones are those who are new to God's love for them. The little ones are those who have grown weak in their faith, the ones who have faced so much pain and sorrow in their own lives that, well, they just don't know what to believe anymore. The little ones are the hurting and the persecuted and the rejected and the outcasts in our midst. These are the ones that Jesus sees and welcomes as a very loved part of the kingdom of God. And who are these people, my friends, you say? Well, take a look around the room this morning. Take a look around the room this morning and you will see. The little ones that God welcomes into the kingdom are you and me. No matter how strong or weak you may be feeling today, you are loved and welcomed to be part of the kingdom of God just as you are. What does that mean to you? What difference does that make in your world today? Once again, just take a look around the room today. Take a look around the room, or if you're at home, take a look around the room where you're at today watching our service. Is there someone you see who needs to know that they are welcome to join this walk of ministry with you? Is there someone around the room today who could use an encouraging word from you? Is there someone who needs to know just how great God's love is for them? Maybe no one has ever told them of this before. Told them that they are loved by the one who sees them when nobody else does. Look for the little ones, for we are one of them. Don't be a stumbling block to those who need you. Instead, welcome them in the name of the one who has welcomed you. And as Scripture says, be at peace with one another. Stay the course with Jesus and walk each day in the humble lesson of God's love for all. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Tim. You know, each week in the series, after we hear the preached word, we're taking time to confess our sins, because it's just important to acknowledge that when we encounter the living word of God, oh man, right away we notice that we often fall short. But little ones, there is always God's healing and forgiveness ready for us. So we remember that we have heard the stories of Jesus' goodness and wisdom, and we remember that as students of Jesus, we know we cannot match his example. In response to God's word, we confess our sins. God, we have proven poor students of the love you have taught. When you asked us to lead, we second-guessed our own understanding. When you offered your strength, we believed more in our weakness. When you were gracious with us, we tested each other, hiding our ignorance and using our knowledge to harm others. We have followed you for so long, but learned so little. Friends, even when we fall short of God's goodness, we must remember our faith began when Jesus rose from the dead to forgive the failure of the cross. Your faith is simply not a test you can fail. It's not. Because Jesus loves you and God always forgives your sins. God, you take away our shame, so even our sinful mistakes can teach the lessons of your gracious love. Thank you, great teacher. Amen. Thank you. So it's kid talk time, and normally I would invite you kids to come meet me up here, but I'm going to come around and talk to you over here today because I want you to stay where you're at. And because I want this to be a little bit of family time. So parents, caring adults who are with your children, these little ones, this is for you too. Pastor Tim gave us this amazing message. We have the opportunity to reflect that we are all these little ones, that we are all God's little ones. But we'd be missing the opportunity if we didn't talk directly to you kids, because you are the literal little ones here today. You're our little ones. And Jesus gives us a warning today, because Jesus warns us that the big people sometimes put stumbling blocks in the way of our little ones. And that means this is like time for some real talk. Kids, I want you to know
that I know and your parents know that you love God in a way that we could not have given to you. We couldn't have made it happen. It's just who you're made to be. We know you love God. But we also know that sometimes, because us big people make faith a really complicated thing, sometimes we make stumbling blocks for you. There may be a day that you, as much as parents fight with kids about church, it is true, there are also days when you kids really want to come to church and we feel like we are too busy or too tired to do it. There are times when you kids really want to talk about God and we get so scared about your questions and your deep questions and your deep comments about God that we just kind of shut it down. There are times when we say we want faith to be so important for you, so we sign you up to Sunday school and we bring you to Vacation Bible School and we do all that stuff, but then we sit out while you're doing all the hard faith work and we don't think about God ourselves, as though we had signed you up for T-ball or something like that. Parents, caring adults who are with children today, Jesus tells us that if something prevents us from allowing the work of God to continue, we got to pluck it out. And today, I want you to take a real raw opportunity to look at the younger ones next to you and say, just this, very honestly, get rid of your pride for a second and say, I am sorry I make you stumble. You could do that now. I am sorry I make you stumble. Jesus loves you, and so do I. Now, here's the other thing I want all of you kids to know, that we big people are little ones too. And all you big people, I want you to remember that you're little ones too. And what that means is that we all, this is why Jesus tells us we need to have the faith like a child. We need to orient ourselves like you kids to ask these big questions and to not be afraid to explore what our faith means. We need to have your curiosity. We need to learn and love God the way you do. So little ones, let's say a prayer together. I'll say a line of this prayer and you say it with me. Jesus, we know. We make each other stumble. But we are seeking you. Come to us. Teach us. We love you. Amen. Thank you. Especially when you're a little one, sometimes you just want someone to tell you what to think or to say. And that's partly what we get in drawing on the deep tradition of the church, to reach back to what generations of Christians have found as their source and confidence, the belief that they didn't have to create, but that has proven trustworthy and true, which is why together we join in saying the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It's time to pray now. And as we do, we remember what the book of James exhorts us, which is that if we are suffering, cheerful, or sick, we should pray. And we should keep each other's prayers together. So let's do that. God, you teach us the power of prayer. Today, align our hearts with your goodwill and move us and your church throughout the world to bring the salt of peace to all. Form us to be people of prayer and agents of grace. Good teacher, hear our prayer.
Creator of all, your good creation cries out under the strain of centuries of abuse and neglect. Forgive our short-sightedness. Teach us to be wise and compassionate stewards of all you have made, to take wonder in and love the things you have made, so we can restore balance and harmony among all living things. Good teacher, hear our prayer. Jesus, you patiently teach us the way of the cross. Broaden our understanding and open our hearts, not only to receive your teaching, but to live it out with boldness and compassion. Make this congregation a sanctuary for all who seek to know you. Good teacher, hear our prayer. Holy Comforter, we pray today for our friends who have requested our intercession and are in need of an extra measure of your grace. Pam Pearson, Connie Sims, Susan Kincaid, Rose Waddell and her family, Viva Rath and family on the death of her husband, Orly, and Helen and Conrad Dice on the death of Helen's sister. Good teacher, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, you've gathered us and given us a holy mission to proclaim Christ and nurture faith that connects to everyday life. Give us what we need for this ministry of reconciliation. Broaden our impact through our ministry partners and bless us so that we may be a blessing to our broken world. Good teacher, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray because we trust in your grace and mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, now we move to our time of offering. It's a really good time for you to share a monetary gift with us to support the work of Christ in this community. But today we also recognize that knowledge, insight, and learning are gifts we should share. So if you wish, this is your time to write down something you've learned today, or as Pastor Tim said, one of those questions you might be carrying. Think about what you've heard in Scripture, preaching, song, and prayer. Write it down. Then you can bring it forward and put it in one of these baskets here during Holy Communion, because we will learn from your insights, as Pastor Tim mentioned. Remember that the doubts, fears, and ignorance and questions of Jesus' disciples became the Gospels that still teach us today. God's Word is alive in this place, and God lives through the things you have learned. Our offering is now received. I know a place where we can go to lay the troubles down, eating your soul. I know a place where mercy flows. Take the stains, make them whiter than snow. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes me come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, 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 the God.
to lay the troubles down, beating your soul.
Before we pray our offering prayer, thank you so much. That was, I told you they were on fire today, right? Before we pray our offering prayer, just a note of apology. We're kind of like in this middle, in-between time with our offering collection where we're moving back to collecting the offering, like passing the plates, but we're also in a place where we don't always have the ushers to do that. So, you know, our ushers are doing amazing work to help move all of you through the sanctuary. And you know, if you're holding onto your envelope and you don't know what to do with it, just put it in the basket on your way out, on the plate on the way out today. I should have told you that before. Now, let's pray this offering prayer. God, our gifts are small next to yours. We cannot understand your wisdom. We do not have your creativity. And no money in this world could buy the power you possess. But you brought forth a child to teach the wise, and you used your followers' questions to teach deeper wisdom. So I will not decide what is useful to you. I will give you my whole self, even that which seems useless, because we believe you work in our lives. Amen. On the night before Jesus died, he recognized his friends would soon forget everything he taught. He taught them to pray without ceasing, but that night their prayers would falter. He taught them to help those in need, but that night they denied him. He taught them that he must die and rise again, but they wept with regret to see their teacher on the cross. Because Jesus knew how easily we forget, he gathered them around bread and wine for one lesson they would always remember. So it was in the night when he was betrayed. Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks for it, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Following the lead of our teacher, we pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So we have four communion stations for you today. There's two here and two here. You just come down the aisle toward the middle to receive Holy Communion, and then go back on the outside to when you're done. Put your hand out to receive a wafer today, and we'll just put one right in there. If you want gluten-free bread, we do have that as well. And if you want a cup of wine or grape juice, just tell us. If you want grape juice, we have that. Otherwise, just put your hand out. We're going to give you some wine. And empty cups go in your waste baskets provided. Again, feel free to bring forward those cards and put them in the baskets. And remember, as you commune today, that faith in God's forgiveness is just not like a lesson you can learn from a book. You got to practice it again and again until the truth of God's healing becomes like a memory in your body. So come up here and take your place at this godly table and practice the habit of godly love.
Mind.
Let's pray. Jesus, in your scripture, you give us the living word that guides our way. At this table, you give us everything we need to turn words into deeds of healing power. Jesus, you have made us apprentices of wisdom and disciples of kindness. Now send us to your world, not as saviors, but as servants, eager to practice what you preach. Amen. Well, some announcements for you before you head out there into the crazy world. It's a little crazy, right? Yeah, a little bit. So, some church stuff to make it feel maybe a little less crazy, more crazy? I don't know.
Your best bet with anything connected to church is to visit our website, because there you can find like all of the announcements for the whole week. And coming up at OSL, our e-news communication has a ton of stuff on there too. We just don't have time to tell you about everything in this church on a Sunday morning. But I do have some highlights for you to share with you. First, we continue preparing for our 75th anniversary at the end of October. I hope you're going to be part of this amazing festival. So get your anniversary merchandise, which we have here at church. Look for a commemorative history book coming soon. And you can contribute to our facility renewal project that has already refurbished the bell tower and shall soon provide for new video walls here in the Celebrate Center. And it allows us to also contribute generously to a couple of our Lutheran camping ministries. Here's a short video that gives you a glimpse of the work that's been completed on the bell tower. I was just talking to one of our guys down on TV before, and they said how happy they are that now they can show a close-up of the cross and not stick to a real wide shot of the way, because it was pretty nasty before. It's beautiful again. Second announcement, you can plan now to be a part of our observance, OSL's observance of Native American Day on October 11th. We have a whole slate of stuff planned with our partners at Augustana University. We're going to have a book read and discussion at 4 o'clock on October 11th. I'm going to help lead that with one of our friends, Beth Boyens. The book is Sacred Wilderness, and we were really smart, and we picked a book that you can really only buy on Kindle. So, but it's half price on Kindle, and I started reading it this last week, super engaging. So it's a novel. Check out Sacred Wilderness on Amazon, and attend the dinner and presentation in the Gathering Place at 5 o'clock here. For more information, to register, go to oslchurch.com. Third, the adult forum between services will be held in the friendship room. So I want you to get together with me. We'll look over some of the insights that people have had in worship today, and also talk about this theme that we see throughout the season where Jesus does a miracle and then tells everyone to not talk about it. So we'll talk, it's called the Messianic Secret. We're going to talk a little bit about that in the adult forum, in the friendship room after worship. Fourth, we have a chance for you to chat about faith and life with Pastor Randy and other OSL members at Theology Tapped. The conversation starts this Thursday around 8 o'clock at Monk's Ale House downtown here in Sioux Falls. Fifth, OSL will welcome the Roseville Lutheran Church Jazz Band in concert on Saturday, October 9th at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary, so I hope you will attend that. So some jazz from one of our fellow groups of Lutheran church musicians, October 9th. Sixth, wow, man. OSL will be hosting a trunk or treat on October 20th, so sign up by October 13th. Decorate your trunk as a vehicle host or to donate treats. And then contact Melissa Nesdahl for more information. If you want to help turn this parking lot into a trunk or treat option, it's going to be a really cool night. Lastly, you can help support this the upcoming Book a Month drive that we're going to host for our partners at Susan B. Anthony Elementary. We want to make sure that every kid in this school gets a book every month. And to sponsor a kid for the whole school year, it's only $20. So if you're interested in helping us with that project, come talk to me or call the church office. We're going to talk about this over the month of October. So just warning you about it now so that you can get ready for that. A book a month for every kid at Susan B. Anthony. All it takes is $20 a student. Okay, now it's time for you to go out and do God's work in the world.
So let me send you with a blessing. Friends, teach with authority, but listen to those whose voice is quiet. Drive away the demons, but treat your enemies with gentleness. Ask your questions, for our questions often reveal more than our wisdom. And do not fear failure, for our faith is not a test we can fail. I send you today in God's peace so that others may learn the lessons of God's love. We will, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Thank you for joining us in worship at Our Savior's Lutheran Church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. For more information about Our Savior's, please visit our website at oslchurch.com and like us on Facebook. We invite you to join us again next Sunday morning. Until next time, may God's abundant love and blessings empower you to share the good news of Jesus Christ.